So Varun,
yes,
is that the way you would like to be called?
Yes.
You are from Karnataka?
Yes, sir.
Bangalore, and you've done engineering?
Yes, sir.
And as I see, you have already been selected, and this is a past exemption twice.
Okay.
You've been selected. And you joined, once you joined IPS, police service.
Yes.
And once you were selected for postal services.
So that was while I was in the police service.
And this is the third time you selected?
So immediately after I got selected to the police service, I was selected even 591st rank. But no service was allocated because I had not been returned.
So what is your goal? Which service you want to work on?
So basically, IPS I was happy. There is no problem.
So that option is no longer there for you, postal service.
You can now only move on to IAS,
yes,
and
central services.
IFS.
No, any service. Also.
Any service. Once service. You quit the job, you are open for any. You can join any service based on the.
I would have preferred police service again, but same problem might happen, so I didn't prefer.
Okay, Varunji would like to know. This new system of CDS, why was it made necessary, and do you agree that this system which has been brought about in the army?
So my limited reading has given me the opinion that this is a suggestion which has started from the Kargil war and thereafter because of the coordination which is required among the various forces. So a CDS would deliver, be a single point man who can deliver an integrated opinion to the defense minister. That way I think it helps. But the concerns could be about the selection of the CDS and where the, which force,
yes,
he has to be taken from, or will the army dominate among the other services. These are the concerns which are raised by the other forces. It can be amicably solved with cooperation. I recently read, sir, that the general who headed the Kargil operation, the army general, he says we cooperate more, better during war time than in peace time. So in peace time, the CDS I think is an ideal solution. We may have one, we should have.
The problem emanated from war time, because in Kargil, when the army wanted air support, it was not forthcoming. And to say that it is during war time we cooperate more and in peace time we don't cooperate.
This was in reference to Balakot strike, sir. So he was giving his opinion that during this strike which recently happened in Pakistan, the opinion I read was that they cooperated. But in peace time these small issues become big and sort of become an issue.
So is it not the senior most person who goes on to become the CDS?
That I need to read up. I have a doubt. I thought of reading it up, but I have not read it. Sorry, sir.
Whosoever is the senior most, not the post has been made permanent. He will be there for 2-3 years, whatever age of retirement, 65. Huh. Normally they retire at the age of 62. So whosoever is the senior most will occupy the post for at least 2 years. Previously, this was a temporary arrangement in which the person who was senior most used to occupy the. But he used,
correct,
to be there only for a month or so. He used to retire thereafter.
Huh.
Now he will not be retiring.
Now it has been made a structured.
It is made a structure. Who's supposed to take over? And what could be the other reason besides this thing, that coordination, when the defense scenario is to be seen? We got the western sector and the eastern sector. We have got China on one side and got Pakistan on the other side. What are the security threats and where CDS is going to help?
So two areas, sir. One is minimization of redundancy of resources which have been distributed, so they can be reduced. And the second is, in the worst case, there can be a two-pronged threat, one from China and the other from Pakistan. So we have to have coordination and try to maximize resource allocation as per the necessity. So there also it will help having a uniform structure where there is communication between the various segments so as to deal with the threats. This is my understanding.
Okay, Mr. Varun, I would also like to know what exactly is the situation, why this Citizen Act has found its most been registered, why so much in Assam? Most violent opposition to it has come from Assam. Why so?
Sir, the Assam Accord was signed in 1985, which guaranteed certain rights to the local populations of population of Assam. And the Citizenship Act tries to reduce the conditions for the incoming migrants of certain categories to have citizenship even in the country, including in Assam. So the contention is that it is directly going against the Assam Accord, where Assam Accord is giving some protection to the locals, while the Citizenship Act is trying to legalize migration and sort of go against the accord. That, in my understanding, is the basic contention.
So what is violated? What provision of the Assam Accord has been violated by this Citizen Act?
So it could be Clause 6 of Assam Accord.
The cutoff date was 1971 in the Assam Accord. And in this, the cutoff date
is 2014.
So what effect it is going to have on the demography of Assam?
So after 1971, whosoever must have come, mainly the contention is the Bengali migrants must have come to Assam and settled down there. So as per the Assam Accord, they should not be given citizenship, but Citizenship Act is giving them citizenship. So there it is a conflict of legislation.
So in the recently NRC exercise, how many were found to be not having citizenship? What is the figure?
So it could be, I tend to forget the exact figures. It is in some lakhs, but I...
19 lakhs, 20 lakhs, how much?
No, sir, I don't recollect.
No, you don't recollect. And how many, what percentage is religious breakup?
In Assam, sir.
In Assam, those who were found to be not citizen of this country. How many were from the Hindu community, how were from the Muslim community? No idea.
Hi, Varun.
Hello, sir.
You have written in your hobbies that you have gone to this Vipassana meditation. What was the reason and idea behind that, going for this meditation?
So basically, immediately after I cleared my engineering exam, my mother sent me to a Vipassana meditation camp for 10 days. So there I picked up the basic technique of meditating. After that, on and off, I used to go for 3 days. Not regularly, but on and off. Not very regularly, but I practice it at home whenever possible.
Which center did you go?
So I went to Chennai for the 10 day. After that, I went to Bangalore itself for 3 days. To Vice I went.
As a ex-police officer, what is your take on this Nirbhaya case going on right now? Regarding the implementation of the law.
Sir, Nirbhaya case in 2012 was an assault on the country itself, and the negative aspect of it is that it has taken this long for the conviction and coming to the closure of the case. Having said that, there are issues with the criminal justice system as a whole, so they have to be rectified. My recent reading of the newspapers, an encounter happened in Hyderabad and there was widespread jubilation about the incident. And the questions were raised whether the jubilation is correct or is it a failure of the overall criminal justice system as such. So this debate has happened because probably the criminal justice system has failed to deliver, the entire system has failed to deliver justice within a time frame. So that, I think, is the deterrence which the society needs. Personally, sir, I would not really consider capital punishment to be a solution, rather than when I weigh it with definite imprisonment for a long time. So that may act as a deterrence. This is my personal opinion with limited reading and understanding.
Okay, let us go on the other side of the social issues. Is that whether men are more corrupt or women are more corrupt?
I don't remember reading any studies in this regard, sir. I mean, both are corrupt or both are not corrupt. I don't see any gender classification of corruption.
Any other hobbies which you have got?
Sir, I used to play the flute, but off late I am not doing it. And I used to practice photography on and off, but not as a professional. So these are the two hobbies I am practicing now.
Okay, who is your role model?
Basically, I find it difficult to have one person as a role model. I take qualities from people and try to emulate them.
Could you venture into a few?
Sorry, ma'am.
Could you explain a few?
Ma'am, for example, I would take the mythical Lord Krishna and try to see that if one has to do something or try to achieve something, one has to put himself into it with a lot of efficiency. So that is one thing which I emulate. Otherwise, Gandhiji, the non-violence aspect I appreciate from Gandhiji. So these are things which I try to pick up from different people and try to instill in myself.
So, like, but then what is your core personality? How would you describe that?
I'm hardworking, ma'am, and sincere and perseverant. So this is how I think I am.
Okay, what do other people think as to how you are?
They think I am a little angry sometimes.
What do you feel about that?
I try to control it also sometimes. I don't personally think I am angry. Maybe some issues I tend to debate and probably that I may come across as angry. But I am really not angry at anyone or at anything. I just, some issues I tend to discuss with passion, so maybe that has given them that kind of...
Anger and health issues have been very closely linked, you know, so what do you feel on that topic?
No, ma'am, I'm not angry as such, but this is the opinion my mother tells me, not anybody else, only my mother says this. Maybe she has seen something in me which is right.
Do you think in the present scenario, social media is aggravating the groupthink process or basically the all the movements that are going on right now? Do you think social media is contributing to it negatively?
Yes, ma'am. The main issue here is regulation of social media. Social media is like an open platform. Nobody regulates it. Everybody is free to air their opinions. Against anybody also, against all issues.
Do you think that, you know, removing social media or a ban on internet and all these things are a good idea?
No, ma'am, not at all. There has to be a via media for communication. Self-regulation, I think, is the idea we have to, like, for example, we have the Press Council of India, which self-regulates and has experts from various areas comprising the Press Council. So we have to probably have something like that for social media as well and try to regulate its activities, bring down content, terrorist content, for example, as soon as it, like we saw in Christchurch, the New Zealand attack. So self-regulation is the way to go. We can't curb the right to expression.
Your hobbies are meditation and?
I take a walk in the park in the morning.
Okay, that is your hobby.
When you cleared your Indian Police Service exam, you were there with them for such a long period. 3 years is not a short period. So what are the strengths you saw in them and what are the weaknesses, if at all, you saw
in the police
in
service?
The service, yes.
So first of all, it was like a family. I mean, I experienced this when we went to Bharat Darshan. I went to Assam and Meghalaya and also to Jammu and Kashmir. So wherever I went, it was a recognition which was immediately made. I mean, people I never knew before, they would recognize me and probably I would salute people, they would salute me. So this was a connection which I didn't know before. So it is a real unifier. That is one thing. Second thing is I have my mentors also in the police service, my SP or the people, my ADOD at the academy. So this mentorship I had not got before. The third thing is discipline, sir. I was disciplined as a young boy also, reading and all that. But then the ways in which we have to carry on ourselves in the society, this I really got to know in the police service for the first time. That was a great experience. So negatives, if I were to be quite frank, we have some practices in the police, like for example, some things which we sort of, some kind of a colonial hangover we have, at least in the some minor aspects. So that maybe we can just change. For example, the boots people wear, it is very difficult to run actually. And probably the men on the standing on the road, they wear khaki. In Karnataka, it has been made white so that they can stand in the sun. And so these things, some relaxation if it is given, so it will be easier for the men on the ground. So these are some things which can change. It is changing and it should change.
So you only form the front line, the boots?
Color uniform, sir. Color of the uniform.
Color of the uniform. Sir, cross belt, for example. That is very, the original purpose was,
What about the attitude? For example, our great visionary Prime Minister, when he took over, he said Indian civil service is neither Indian, nor civil, nor a service.
What? The SEST, so as to instill, sort of cooperation of the people towards eradicating social ills. Yes, it is true that we have a colonial hangover. We are following a system which was designed by the British for an unfree country. But then to say that British system has stayed on till now without any change, I think that is a very unfair estimation of the civil services.
No, nobody is disputing that there will be no change. Changes are peripheral, votes and uniform, not the substantial, which is the mindset.
Having that said, sir, police reforms are required. For example, the separation of investigation and law and order. That was recommended in the Prakash Singh case in 2006. But the latest I read was in many of the states these have not been implemented. The police establishment board for giving fixed tenure and for transfers and postings, the board has to be responsible. The civil services board have been recommended for transfers and postings because these are the issues based on which the political executive will have some leverage on the officers. So there has to be independence of tenure, and to be fearless there has to be an atmosphere where fearlessness is encouraged, it is incentivized. I remember reading in the Administrative Reforms Commission that corruption has become a low risk, high incentive activity. So that has to change and make sure that integrity and ethics becomes an incentivized activity. So civil service and police reforms are happening, should happen more. Having said that, I think it is still a steel frame. We actually depend on the civil services to a lot, to a large extent in this country for the running, and as a welfare state also. We are changing, and I see that happening every day.
My last question on this aspect, that end of the day, the police that we have benefits whom? For example, in Delhi you have New Delhi area, you have South Delhi area, you have Ambedkar Nagar and Mangalpuri area. In one police station, the police station walks up to the complainant, the MPs, the bureaucrats. Even if your dog is lost, the police station will walk up to you, take your complaint. Within the city, within the capital, you have another set of area where they see whether you have a network or money in the pocket. South Delhi, any work is done, can be done in police, is the perception. And then you have Mangalpuri, Ambedkar Nagar, all marginalized areas of Delhi, where even the constable can slap you out, shoo you out, what to talk if anything else. As against this scenario, system works similarly all across. A system which benefits the powerful and the rich, who are decision makers, who will change. If I am hit, I will change. I am not hit, I feel the police is very efficient, as you are saying, because you are a part of the system for some time. you have seen that part of it. So you say everything is fine, let's have the peripheral change. But those who are not, they feel everything is wrong because we don't have access to this system. I'm just trying to provoke you because these questions are raised when you get a little deeper.
Sir, I would like to say that the truth somewhere lies in the between. Not everything is wrong, right? Things are wrong. We have to make sure that we have to set things right. Having said that, there is one example which I would like to quote. My SP in Prakasham district, there was once an old lady who had come because her son was beating her up. It was a case of violence at home. So the SP simply had could have deputed one of his deputies or the SI concerned to take it up in a very police way, so to say. But he made sure that one constable had to go home and called the son to the in front of me. I was sitting right there. And he had this duty, moral duty, took it upon himself to advise the man not to do it again and instill some fear on him. None of this was required. It was a job which was out of the bounds of law. If there are bad examples in the society, there are very good examples which probably go unnoticed. So what has to be done is a structural change. Give the policemen, give the civil service sufficient leeway so that they can be powerful. So systems have to be designed rather than ad hoc systems.
Who do this?
Sir, I think it's a combination of legislations and public opinion, enlightened public opinion. That I think should be the drive in a democracy. It can't come from the top, it has to also come from the bottom.
Sorry for dragging, because he was an insider, so I thought, let's get a deeper
through.
So you are from Karnataka, Bangalore, your mother tongue is Kannada.
Yes.
How come in NPA you got a trophy for Telugu?
Sir, I was allotted Andhra Pradesh card. We were seven people, sir. So we used to take classes for Telugu.
Telugu language you were learning?
Telugu language, sir. So I was topper among them, so they gave me a trophy.
Very good.
We wrote an exam.
Yeah, I know.
I got the first place.
Very good. And you were later remained in Andhra or you went to Telangana?
Andhra Pradesh, sir.
Remained in Andhra. You just now told me about Prakasam district.
Yes,
sir. Earlier to this board, in one of the questions you talked about self-regulation by social media. And you said that press council is there to... What happens in print media, whatever is written comes out in public domain. But in social media, it goes only to a limited people. And if it is to be regulated, then somebody has to snoop. Go into some hack what is being sent. Some kind of spying or tapping or something. So these two are not exactly identical. So, have you given thought to this?
Yes, sir. Sir, I keep reading about artificial intelligence being used, robots being used to influence elections in the US, and probably steal private data, private forms of communication. People also unknowingly put every data which they have on Facebook and Twitter without knowing where it is going. And there is a move to, I don't know how far it has gone, to link social media accounts with Aadhaar. So these are the issues. The basic issues are the right to privacy, freedom of expression, and how safe the data is. Are the data being manipulated or used for commercial purposes?
No. Now my question, I'll repeat it again.
Sorry.
When in case of print media, the press council can lay down guidelines and policy and expect newspapers to follow it.
Okay.
When they have not followed it, a complaint is made. They will compare what they have done with the guidelines. But in case of, you said there should be self-regulation in social media. The social media is not open to public domain. It circulates within a limited set of people. So unless there is some kind of spying, snooping, how will the regulator come to know what is being said?
Sir, here the producer of information is not a body, it can be an individual, and we don't even know where he is. So actually regulating him and controlling him becomes very difficult. That is the challenge of technology. But what probably can be done is employment of artificial intelligence to recognize such accounts. I remember reading that Twitter accounts were suspended of those people who, you know, generally are not individuals. So this artificial intelligence and machine intelligence or some other name, I forget. So technology has to be used, I think, sir, in my opinion, to regulate this domain.
Okay, so technology will see what is being done.
Yes.
Whether the same statement or fact can have different impact in different context. There has to be somebody, human being, to press the button. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Stop this circulation.
Correct.
So that will cease to be self-regulation.
Yes. It is a thin line we have to.
I mean, so you have to articulate your this problem in that way. It is not like self-regulation can lead it to.
Okay.
You said that this is a colonial hangover in police. He asked you several questions. Can, apart from the uniform, which is very peripheral, the color of uniform is set. The khaki as a color of uniform has been chosen because it gels with the geographical pattern. A few decades ago, a couple of decades ago, the Goa police changed the uniform to white and blue. And later they again got it, they complained, we don't look like policemen, nobody fears us, we look like band people, musical band. And then the police protested and they got back to khaki. So there is something much more than color uniform, it has to be. The army wears OG because they thought that they have to work in jungles. But army also wears khaki in desert areas. The khaki color of police is because of...
It is something more than the colors.
Because of the geographical area where they have to operate. So white, I mean traffic police has been wearing white not because of climate but because of visibility. So that they can be seen from a distance. So coming to colonial hangover, apart from the unis, can you list 2-3 things which you find wrong with the police because of colonial hangover? Just 2 or 3 things.
Again, I would, if I were to say about the uniform itself, the cross belt.
Uniform is out. Forget uniform. Cross belt can be changed by DG police by honor. You don't wear cross. Some states have done it. I'm not talking about the uniform or IPS. I'm working on police. I mean, you said that colonial hangover. Did you mean uniform of police or working on police organization?
Sir, if I were to say working on the police in some states, I remember reading, is still the authority who is writing the reports of the SP will be the DC.
That's not, I'm talking about how the police works. Police works in interface with public. I mean, when you talk about working of police system, you don't mean internal things like who writes ACR, what uniform. When it interacts with citizens, do you think that the performance is dictated by colonial spirit and what are those areas?
Yes and no, sir, again here, because yes, we function, the police functions in a way which is sometimes not in the strictest principles of welfare state rather than a police state. So that is not the entire reality also, because we have empathetic people in the police service also. I say this repeatedly because I have seen people who are empathetic. So I have an opinion that yes, we need to change towards becoming more empathetic. And grievance redressals. I remember that police SPs give out their phone numbers on the social media so that there is 24/7 access. So this is definitely a welfare state. This was not at all there, even conceptualized in the, during the time of the British. So we are changing, but there are hangovers wherein we tend to behave like a police state, in the sense we don't give much thought to feedback we get. And we operate in a way which doesn't give too much importance to probably emotions. That is there, but we are changing, sir. I have a very positive attitude about the change which is happening because of what I have seen.
So you were undergoing training in Greyhounds. From NPO, you must have gone for jungle training.
Yes.
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
And then your Greyhound posting is mandatory for everybody in Andhra Pradesh. So apart from duration, what is the other thing different between the two?
Between
the jungle training given as to an IPS professional and Greyhound training given to police officers of Andhra Pradesh.
Sir, there actually in the 3-month training, it is not a simulation. One actually goes inside a forest and carries out operations. Sometimes people face real fire. One of my friends narrowly missed it. So it is not a simulation, but actually combing operations, dropping at night and trying to capture them, running behind them. The Greyhounds are famous for actually running behind them and shooting them down. So these actually is done. This is not a simulation, actual exercise which happens, a 3-month exercise. As an officer of special duty, one is given charge of a subdivision and Ram Pachodavaram in Andhra Pradesh or some such area in the Vijayanagaram agency and around, where one has to take the operations on the Andhra-Orissa border. Now it has reduced, but a few years ago it was quite high. So one has to actually lead the operations and take part in it. That is how it is actually. The NPA training is just an overview, sir, just to appreciate what happens for everybody, all cadres.
Okay, coming back to this Greyhound training, you said that we are supposed we run after actual Nakshals and shoot them down. If you are running after somebody and you shoot him down, isn't this blood and butter?
Sir, that is only happening if they are firing. I mean, if they are unarmed, it doesn't happen. They start firing at us. So, the only way to deal with those people is they run away and again come and attack. So, the combat which happens is a shootout. It's not a shoot at them. It's a shootout which happens. So,
but nobody will actually come back and hit the police. When they found that the Greyhound is notorious, fearful police has Greyhound, they just try to run away and disappear. Than to take risk of shooting at the Greyhound people.
So generally what happens is, they merge with the population of the area. The tribe, it is very difficult to isolate them and identify this person as an Naxalite and this person as not an Naxalite. Hmm. So once they merge, it is impossible to again see who is what, and it's next to impossible. Hmm. So the only way is to either capture them. The first instinct is to capture them. But why in the process of capturing, what happens? I remember reading a story where people were evacuating.
You tell me your experience. Did you any come across any incident of actually changing the Naxal?
No, sir. I personally did not.
The story is yours. Okay.
Only two things. What is the status of this Kaveri water dispute now?
Sir, the last I read was the Supreme Court ordered 10 TMC feet of water to Bangalore for drinking water purposes from the water which is allocated to Tamil Nadu. That is in line with the water policy of 2018, if I'm right. That is the latest I read. But now there is a Kaveri Water Agency, if I'm right, Water Management Agency, which is the body which actually
allocates water,
administers the tribunal of water. This is the last I've heard.
So Supreme Court has given the final judgment.
I'm not
aware. Then. What is the status of the farmer suicide in Karnataka?
So exact figures I am not aware, but suicides do happen, I remember reading, and mainly because of the drier areas of Karnataka where water stress is there, and also because of the choice of crops farmers employ. For example, one example which readily comes to my mind is in the leeward side of the Western Ghats, in the Mandya area, because of the KRS, people grow sugarcane on either side of the border, both in Tamil Nadu and in Karnataka, while it is not suited to grow a water guzzling crop. So what happens is sometimes they grow, there is no demand, we export sugar, basically we are exporting water from a water deficit region. So this has to be over a period of time changed. The cropping patterns have to change in order to suit the local condition, climatic conditions. So this has to be possible only by an enlightened public and political opinion. Over a period of time, it has to be changed.
But as long as the sugar cane, sugar mills are there, lot of sugar mills have been established in that area in Karnataka.
It is difficult to actually go.
So as long as the sugar mills are there, if they don't grow sugar cane, then the mills will be suffering.
That is a reality, sir. That is a ground reality.
So maybe it is water guzzling, but as long as the sugar mills are there, then how will it do? And
sir, I say this because I may be wrong, but we export sugar, it seems. So if we are doing that, basically we are exporting water. I mean, we need water, but we are exporting water.
See, can we say about paddy also? Paddy is also, once it is exporting, you are not exporting paddy, you are exporting water.
I don't know which policy lays this down, but millets are being supported these days. Mainly because it is a nutritional food. And secondly, because in the era of climate change also, they require less water. So it's a part of climate adaptation. So there are paddy growing areas, but if there are water deficit regions, so we have to consider shifting over from paddy to millets or ragi.
So this Madhav Gadgil and the other Kasturi Rangan report, how adversely does it affect Karnataka?
So Madhav Gadgil and Kasturi Rangan report are basically about the Western Ghat ecological areas, recommendation of eco-sensitive areas in the region. And they differ a little, but mainly the crux of the recommendation is that highly endemic areas have to be reserved and should not be diverted for industries which are polluting or which destroy the ecology of the region on a large scale. But then the contention is that farmers will not be able to grow and industries will not come up, thereby hampering development.
How is it affecting the farmers adversely?
Sir, because if the forests are diverted to cultivation, it results in monocropping in a diverse area, because the Silent Valley National Park, for example, in Kerala, or also in Western Ghats, which is part of Karnataka. So diversion of forest land for agriculture goes, for example, if one example, bees. Bees depend on diverse plants. If there is monocropping, suppose even there is a flower also, it depends on one kind of flower only. So that, I remember reading, hampers the quality of nectar which the bees can produce.
The whole report was with regard to a number of villages which are going to be affected, and there were only two classifications as far as industries are concerned, the red and the whole concept was about having polluting industry which are to be permitted, industry which are not to be permitted. Agriculture is not adversely affected in that.
Maybe I'm mistaken.
Okay.
Thank you, dear.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.